Let's go to California, where Emil Guillermo is standing by. He is the host of the PETA Podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. And we got a lot to talk about. We took a week off, so it's been a week, right?
Yeah, I missed you, David.
I missed you, too. And I thought of you because Paul Manafort, who's on trial in Washington, D.C. for tax evasion, spent, what, $25,000 on an ostrich jacket?
I think that elevates him somewhat. I think it was 15, but if you count the python jacket, then maybe he's up to 25. I don't know, but it's, yeah, it was high. 15 for the ostrich, though.
Where do you wear that?
I keep thinking, you know, the only ostrich thing I know of are like those, you know, obscene cowboy boots and maybe a Birkin bag. Those are really hip now among, you know, the ultra rich. And I was just thinking, oh, I just can't believe you would take the ostrich skin and make it into a jacket and then wear that with all the little bumpy quills. Like
ostrich skin or ostrich feathers?
No, these are it's like the skin. It's the not feather. Feathers would make him sort of like a Carmen Miranda kind of figure. But ostrich, this is like, you know, the what are they? You know, the things that the quills come out of, right? The bumps. The bumpy skin of an ostrich. They call it the diamond area of the back of an ostrich, because that's where the money is. That's where the money's made. They pull the quills out of the back, and then with the skin, they separate that from the ostrich, and they make bags and boots and Paul Manafort's coat.
For whom?
Rich people. This is a luxury
tacky
business.
Tacky, you know, tasteless.
And, you know, people talk about, oh, this is an 80s thing. No, this is a modern thing. It's not like something out of the 80s. It's something out of very modern, high fashion 2018. The Birkin bag is a big, hip bag that rich people will pay $25,000, $30,000 for a bag, a handbag. Luxury lines like Prada, Hermes, the Birkin bag, like you said, $25,000 and more for a bag.
Forget the cruelty to animals.
Yeah.
We'll put that on the back burner for one second.
For a second, yes.
What about the cruelty to humans? And I'm being serious. What is wrong?
In terms of like being subjected to looking at this, the cruelty to our being, to, you know, someone walks in with an ostrich anything, yeah, and it's offensive to us.
It's secondhand ostrich skin. It's one thing to wear it. Why do I have to see it?
Well, it is really offensive, I think. But I think it gets more offensive when you think about the cruelty. But the look of it, you know, there's a phrase that you use in Hawaii. I lived in Hawaii for a couple of years, and they say, oh, that gives me chicken skin. Well, ostrich skin is like 100 times chicken skin. If you think of what it's like to get chicken skin when your skin freezes up and, you know, you get all those bumps. Well, mm-hmm. Ostrich is like 100 times worse, because they're big bumps. And I guess that's why they charge more for the bumps. The bumpier the skin, the more the profits for the people who skin the ostriches. But there are some people who find that attractive. Maybe my cowboy boot wearing days in my 20s, I might have. I lived in Texas and, you know, back in the urban cowboy days.
Yeah.
Ostrich skin boots were like the rage among, you know, the urban cowboys who went to, you know, Gillies and, you know, did all that. You know, John Travolta and Deborah Winger.
It's grotesque.
It is grotesque.
Ostrich skin is grotesque. That's why ostriches bury their head in the sand. They don't want to look at each other. It's gross. What is wrong with people?
You know, David, you know, you do some things like, you know, you binge listen to the PETA podcast and you hear me talk to these people and talking about lab experiments to animals. And this week we're going to talk about to the investigator who actually went to South Africa, where 75% of the luxury ostrich skin is processed.
Are there ostrich farms?
There are ostrich. They raise the ostriches. They bring them to slaughter. And how they do it, they've got PETA investigators captured some never-before-seen footage of the process. And all you have to do, if you have any ounce, I mean, look, you're a different kind of person. So when you see ostrich skin, you are so offended, even before the cruelty part, that, you know, you want to talk about the aesthetic offense, you know, to your total being, which I get, I understand. But there are some people who just, they find some kind of attraction to those little bumps, like, I know, it's like warts, like venereal warts on a jacket. It's, I don't know, I don't see how
now that,
how
that I would like. Where do I get that?
Yeah,
I'd like you to clean my venereal warts, Martinize it, please, and no penicillin.
Oh, Martinizing. That, I haven't heard that in a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah. Okay, also on the PETA podcast, which you can download on iTunes, you talk about the community cat scam, non-feral ferals. Now, these are cats
These are cats that are out there in the feral community, but they're not really feral. You know, what happens is...
You're talking about Google feeding cats, right?
I'm talking about people who have these organizations. They try to build up their stats to show that they're doing something. So they'll get these cats that they can't adopt or that they can't, you know, find people to adopt. And they will clip their ears.
Their claws.
No, clip their ears.
Now
clip
you have to ears. Declaw their head? You have to get...
No, they'll clip their ears so they identify them, and then they'll release them out into the community. And they call them community cats. It's really kind of a self-serving thing for some of these organizations. And some of them are well-meaning. But because they don't want to euthanize these cats that they can't find homes for, they clip their ears, they release them out to the community. They call them community cats, and they're asked to fend for themselves against real feral cats, and they're not feral. They're really domesticated young.
Are they spayed?
They spay them, yes.
Okay.
They spay and neuter them, but they release them. And they think they're doing everyone a favor by not euthanizing them.
Well, you think they should be euthanized?
I don't believe in no-kill shelters. And PETA also is a very anti-no-kill shelter.
You're kidding.
No. That's one of the big issues.
I had no idea.
Well... If you know how many, you know, animals are out there who cannot be adopted, you should, you know, understand that no-kill only exacerbates the problem. Right. They turn people away from shelters. They don't have low-cost spay and neuter. They don't, you know, and some of these organizations, they'll spay and neuter the cats and release them in the wild. Which I think is more dangerous to the cat, because a cat goes out there in the feral community. They're not feral. They're trying to fit in. They're kind of undercover feral cats.
You are really getting me to hate San Francisco even more than I possibly could.
I don't know how I can do that.
We're both from San Francisco. I see those pseudo-intellectual TED Talks that are really, you know, motivational scams.
Right.
And
right. They
say anything is possible. Look at San Francisco's Humane Society. They put their heads together and they created a no-kill shelter.
Right, right.
San Francisco does not kill cats or dogs.
Right. And
now you're saying that by not killing cats and dogs, they are killing cats and dogs.
Well, by not killing cats and dogs, they're avoiding the real solution, which is they've got to do something about the spaying and neutering, about the overpopulation problem. Until you get that in order, there's nothing, there's no real humane thing to do except to euthanize.
Are you saying are you saying that they create a moral hazard? There's no responsibility because San Francisco will take cats and dogs. Nobody feels obligated to spay and neuter their cats. Is that what you're saying?
What I'm saying is, and once again, I don't speak for PETA. These are my views. But PETA basically does believe they have an anti no kill, stance. In fact, they have a shelter, and it's a shelter of last resort, because when people get pushed away from all the no kill shelters because there's no room and there's no place for the animals, where are they going to go? You see, a lot of people end up abandoning their animals out in the wild, or they go to a shelter of last resort like PETA's, which is operating it operates an animal shelter in the Norfolk, Virginia, North Carolina area there. So I'm saying that
I'm not shelters, trying to be glib here. Is it a kill shelter? Do you pretty much assume it's going to be euthanized painlessly in Norfolk?
Euthanizing is usually the answer if there are no adoptions. That's just the reality. That's always been the reality for sheltering. And this no-kill idea.
Are you saying in San Francisco people get turned away at the Humane Society?
I can tell you if that's happening right now in terms of like this minute, but this happens in no-kill shelters where they're so full up that they cannot accommodate all the animals, and they put them on waiting lists. This is what happens with the no-kill shelters, and why the no-kill policy is a bogus one. It allows people to skirt the responsibility of being moral and humane, and it gives people an out, and it's not right. And so getting back to the community cat story, the whole reason why I got into the community cat issue is because a community cat crossed my path. And, you know, when my wife and I saw it, there was nothing else we could do except to adopt the damn thing. And we got dogs. We didn't need another cat, or we didn't need a cat. But there we are. It's an orange tabby, and we named it Emma Orange Peel, or Emma Peel, or the, Emma Orange
the
Peel.
Avengers.
The Avengers, yes. The original Avengers, not the comic book guys, but mm-hmm. the real Avengers.
Patrick, what was his name?
McNee. Patrick McNee. Patrick McNee and Emma Peel, who was played by?
Diana Rigg.
Sounds like Diana Rigg. Rigg, yes.
She was in the New York Times this week, looking beautiful.
That's a coincidence. I've got the unread Sunday Times, or the unread Times with her in it, and the cat crossed my path, and I was just thinking about how she's an orange tabby, and we already have a black border collie called Robin Pearl Beyonce, and so I was thinking about another kind of cultural kind of image, like, you know, Emma Peel. And
now, have any positions on the cruelty of naming animals? I mean, does that count as cruelty?
The cruelty, I think Robin Pearl Beyonce, you know, for a black dog is a perfect name for a black dog. No, they don't censor us in terms of what we name our companion animals. I named one of my companion, or both of my, or two of my companion animals after my late mother and father, so that they were always around. There's Willie and Josie. Anyway.
Well, I am Googling what you're telling me, and
yes, please Google. Look, I'm telling you, David, the whole idea of the no-kill.
How the San Francisco SPCA let us down.
Yeah. Now, listen to episode one where I talk of the PETA podcast, where I talk to Ingrid Newkirk, the president and co-founder, and she'll tell you why no-kill shelters are a sham. And then go to my the PETA podcast with Daphna Nekminovich, who runs the shelter at PETA. It's one of the, I think she's podcast number 14, I'm not sure, but Daphna Nekminovich talks about what the PETA no-kill shelter, or what the PETA shelter does, and why it fills a need when no-kill shelters fail. So,
are you saying, like, they possibly pass the dogs on to shelters that do kill when they're
Telling you that no-kill shelters are good up until they're filled to capacity. But when they're filled to capacity, they have no answers, and they have no room. And so people who have problem animals can't go to them, and there is no place to go. And they can't spay, they can't neuter. The no-kill has changed sheltering for the worst. And I think that people need to wise up and see that, well, we got to do more spaying and neutering. We've got to control the population. And when we can't control the population, the most humane thing to do is to euthanize these animals that can't find homes. So it's a sad thing, but we don't skirt the moral issue, which no-kill shelters definitely do.
This is from NPR, who you were the voice of.
For a time. A short time.
It's been 20 years since San Francisco helped start a revolution and became the first U.S. community to guarantee a home to every adoptable dog and cat. Since then, the no-kill movement has been credited with reducing the number of dogs and cats that are euthanized from some 20 million down to about 3 million each year. Well, that's not bad.
Well, you know, if you can place them in homes, you know, what happens? I mean, they didn't euthanize those animals. Well, what happens to the ones that they weren't able to place? What, you know, you got to be suspicious of the number, is what I'm saying. Which goes back to the whole community cat thing. People inflate their numbers. Oh, look at what we did. We spayed and neutered these cats. Did they find homes for them? No. They released them to the community. They're now non-feral cats.
Yeah.
Left to their own devices. And hopefully someone like myself and my wife will stumble on them and save them.
Yeah.
Which is not the right process, the right procedure, if we're going to really do something about the problem. So
finally, PetSmart. We've gone after PetSmart on this show before. Mm-hmm. They're still being cruel to pets.
Well, they are in a way. This is a case that happened in Nashville. The managers there, because of a PetSmart policy, were told to cut corners. You know, don't feed, don't take care of sick animals. You know, don't reorder feed, because if you have a surplus in your budget, that budget will go back in terms of bonuses to management. Now, you get an incentive like that, and managers will go out of their way to be cruel and unkind to the animals that are being housed, you know, ready for sale, right?
Mm-hmm.
That was the case in this one PetSmart store in Nashville. They had to seize some animals, send them to vets. They arrested three people on cruelty charges, and they pled out. Just recently, they pled out. They pled guilty. They were convicted. And PetSmart, instead of firing them, kept them on as employees. Now, you tell me, if you are a legit organization that cares for animals, and you had animal cruelty charges, you had three managers convicted of animal cruelty charges, I would think you'd want to get rid of them. But PetSmart keeps them.
Well, it sounds like they probably don't pay their managers enough.
Well, or they don't believe in the mission. Well, there's no mission. The mission is to make money.
Yeah.
And what they do is they use these poor animals that they sell. And we're not talking, these aren't cats and dogs. They don't do cats and dogs there at PetSmart. These are the little animals. These are the hamsters, the guinea pigs, the mice and the rats, the animals that no one cares about until they care about them because they see how cute they are. They're the loss leaders because they get consumers to buy this stuff, and then consumers buy millions upon millions of dollars of all this ancillary stuff like cages and, terrariums and feed and all that stuff. And that's how PetSmart makes their money, as a big box enabler of your addiction to buying stuff for your loved companion animal, which they were glad to starve and get, and not treat. And this is what's happening in Nashville, or it happened in Nashville, and PetSmart has kept them on.
Before you go, Alex Jones from InfoWars has been shut down by Apple. You can't get his podcast on Apple. You can't find him on Facebook, YouTube, or Spotify.
Mm.
What is the... Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead. Well, you can find us on all those things. So I guess that's good for them. They've recognized quality.
Alex Jones has accused some of the kids being killed at these shootings. He said they're crisis actors. He's created a lot of trouble for these families, death threats. They're suing him. What responsibility, you're a professional journalist, what responsibility does Google, Facebook, and YouTube, what do they owe Alex Jones?
They owe Alex Jones nothing. They gave him a free platform. If anything, it's amazing that they allowed him to stay on for as long as they did. I mean, they finally realized that this guy was not performing any kind of public service. He was adding to the nonsense. You want to talk about fake news? I mean, that's the fake news, not the real news of that's being offered up by the networks and newspapers. It's these guys who are doing podcasts and abuse the privilege of their First Amendment rights and abuse the access to outlets like YouTube and Facebook and Twitter and, to incite to do these things. I mean, look, I think it's about time they did this to Alex Jones. Look, I have sort of followed Alex Jones tangentially. I know he's been in the news. I know what he does. I've been on terrestrial talk radio back in the day, and that's why a bigger talk radio story this week to me would have been the 30th anniversary of Rush Limbaugh and Donald Trump appearing on the Limbaugh show for that 30th anniversary, because I say everything went, political rhetoric in this country went to hell with the rise of Rush Limbaugh. And I think that's worthy of note.
And is it the elimination of the fairness doctrine that facilitated Rush Limbaugh?
It wasn't the facilitation of the fairness doctrine, although that helped, because when you didn't have to, come on with an opposing view to balance, the extreme view, he was able to get away with stuff. But what really happened was that people realized that Rush Limbaugh made money. And he had this phrase about, his show was about charging confiscatory rates and to get these huge profits. Well, that was what he was about. And he was the one who tapped into this. I think Trump appearing on Limbaugh's 30th anniversary was telling, because Trump has done the same thing with real politics. I mean, Limbaugh, was a DJ. He was the one who plays Ring My Bell, you know, Anita Ward's Ring My Bell, and on his show, and he talks to vocal. He was a big DJ out of the Midwest. He's from Missouri. And if he had gone to WLS and had been the afternoon drive guy, that would have been perfect. But he, you know, his family, a family of lawyers. He got into politics and this right wing stuff. And he knew how to take show business and rhetoric and sell it.
And he got his talking points from the Koch brothers funded people.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I remember when he first started, when he was first starting to really make waves, 88. He first started 89. I was at NPR, and I remember who's this Limbaugh guy everyone was listening to. And I was on, you know, All Things Considered, and I could see how he was growing, and I could see how people were listening to him, and how people were just, you know, gravitating to him. And that really was the beginning of the kind of polarization, because that's what that kind of radio is all about.
Well, it's not polarization, it's misinformation.
Well, misinformation,
unchecked.
But
it's unchecked.
Well, it is. And I'll tell you, when I left, I never saw talk radio as journalism. When I left journalism and did talk radio, I tried to make, when I left, legitimate journalism as, you know, as a reporter. And I took a role as a talk host. I didn't see myself as a journalist, although I used journalistic technique. I used fact. I tried to check sources. All these other guys were just showmen. And so when they tried to use journalistic technique, but, you know, selectively, I always felt it was odd to be in that realm, because it wasn't pure. It was, they'll say anything off the top of their heads. They'll, you know, it was Rush Limbaugh. And also, it was to generate audience. Misinformation, but misinformation to polarize, essentially, and to get people to listen and create conflict. They were dramatists, right? They were creating drama and creating ratings. And it's lasted now a generation. And we have people who think that, oh, that's the way it's always been.
And he, you know, builds talk himself radio as America's anchor man, Rush Limbaugh.
Yeah,
people get their news from Rush Limbaugh and Sean Hannity. That's who's
right. Because, yeah, and you know, and they were always saying, "Look, you don't have to get the news, because we'll give you the news. We'll tell you how to think." I mean, this was all just. Yeah. This is the way it works in authoritarian countries, right? And when he's so chummy with Trump, and so chummy with those in power, I mean, even the so-called left, well, there was no, well, I guess there was some left-wing talk radio for a while, but no one, if you're doing it right, you're not chummy with anyone. Mm-hmm. You know, you hate the left, you hate the right. I mean, you do it journalistically. But right now, it's because of Rush Limbaugh, I lost my job as a talk radio host, because when everything was going rightward, and when Newt Gingrich won the House back in 94, all the talk radio stations said, okay, well, that's it for unbiased talk radio. We're going rightward. And now you try to find a liberal on a talk radio station. It's almost impossible, unless they're on the so-called left wing or progressive dials. And there are none. Well, there are.
You have Randy Rhodes. You have Stephanie Miller. You don't have locally owned radio stations anymore, because they've relaxed all those rules.
And that's one of the problems, too, because for a while when I was in talk radio, you could always rely on at least two radio stations. They had at least a full deck of staff, you know, to man the microphones, or to run the microphones. And now with the rise of syndication, Rush Limbaugh, you have whole stations that are just all syndicated, and they might have one local guy in the morning doing the introduction to Rush, mm-hmm. or doing the noon show. It's very rare. And thank goodness for podcasts, because podcasts have democratized talk programming so that you can get whatever you want.
The problem is it's democratized it to the point where there's no barrier to the entry level.
Oh, right.
Anybody can do it.
And there's too many shows, and there's a glut of shows, and so everyone gets a little piece of the pie. Yeah. A little piece of the pie. Emphasis on little. But it's out there, and, you know, that's something. But I think that, look, Alex Jones being banned, thank goodness, but, you know, there are other Alex Joneses out there who aren't as big, who spread their conspiracies and do their thing. And so, but if you go after the, he's sort of the big dog. Yeah. And so maybe he'll set an example, his being lopped off will be an example to others. Although he's still going to have his audience. I'm sure he'll be on the web somewhere. You know, he doesn't have to be on Facebook. It's easier. For ease of the audience to find him, but his audience will find him.
Yeah.
And so that's,
all right. We have to wrap it up, my friend. We'll come back next week.
David, it's always a pleasure to talk to you about...
All right. Stay on the line. Emil Guillermo is the host of the PETA Podcast, and you can read him regularly over at the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund. What is the website, sir?
aldef.org, aldef.org/blog. Also, you can check me out on amok.com. That's my personal website. My one-man show, All Fucked Up, the Amok Monologues, coming August 17th to San Francisco.
Beautiful. Stand in line for 1 second, sir.
Yep. Yeah.